Welcome to the Future of Dermatology podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Farah Kamangar, board-certified dermatologist. Along with being a dermatologist and the host of this podcast, I am also the president of the San Francisco Dermatological Society, which is composed of dermatologists who practice in the San Francisco Bay Area. Every year, we hold our annual SF Derm meeting, and this year we gathered our guests at the Ritz-Carlton in Half Moon Bay. From engaging sessions to incredible food and even a round of golf, SF Derm 2024 was a huge success. Continue listening to hear thought-provoking conversations from our incredible dermatologists who presented on matters that answer your dermatology questions, align with our goals, and provide insight to the future of dermatology.
I want to introduce Dr. Hamzavi. Iltefat has been my friend ever since as a resident. He drove me from the Detroit airport to Henry Ford Hospital. It was about 20 plus years ago. went to college and medical school at University of Michigan. He did his derm training at Wayne State and British Columbia. And he's the one who came up with the VASI score with colleagues at the University of British Columbia, which is the number one outcome measure for vitiligo, the Vitiligo Area Severity Index. So some people call him Dr. Hamvasi, not Hamzavi, because of that, because he's so famous. But he also has a heart for people with hidradenitis suppurativa. He really cares about his patients to be able to be an expert in both vitiligo and hidradenitis. And so I can give you all sorts of accolades about his 300 publications and stuff, but the most important thing I can tell you is this is a man of great, great character, a man who really cares emotionally for his patients and does what it takes to help them and help his colleagues and his friends and his family. So that's the best thing I can tell you about Ilt. So let me introduce Iltefat.
Wow, that's a very generous introduction from a very, very close mentor and friend. So I think what we experienced just with Dr. Field's lecture and Dr. Pandia's lecture is part of this community of dermatology, and it's very nice to be here in San Francisco with all of you today at Half Moon Bay, which is colder and has less sun than Detroit, and I'm wondering why I came here for vacation. But enough about my day. But you're welcome to come to Detroit in the summer, anytime. Conflicts of interest. Yeah, so conflicts of interest. I didn't have any before, but now we have all these companies interested in our field. I think a reflection of our specialty advocating for these patients. In my hometown of Detroit, it's sunny right now. This is the epic duo crisscross. And I like to imagine Dr. Pandia and myself as 1990s young rap stars. So we're going to hit you some rhyme. We're going to hit you with some beats. We're actually going to hit you with music that people want to listen to, unlike the stuff that comes out of San Francisco. We're the home of Eminem. We're the home of Kid Rock. We're the home of Motown. San Francisco, you got Journey. Okay. Talk about depression. So depression. I think one of the things I wanted to emphasize and quickly kind of provide some data to what Dr. Pandia presented, we've done a large study looking at thousands of patients throughout the world, published in JAMA Derm, JAD, BJD. It was funded through a grant from Insight, but it was independently run by a bunch of us. And basically, we just kind of put out social media filters. We found patients throughout the world who had vitiligo, and we wanted to track what impact this disease has, because we tell you that it's having a tremendous mental and psychosocial impact, but how do we quantify that? And, you know, I'll walk through some of the characterizations and the respondents, but it was thousands of patients, and we were able to establish a filter, and around 3,541 patients were analyzed. And you had a tremendous impact on self-esteem, relationships, and careers based upon the overall BSA. The greater the extent of vitiligo, the greater the impact on your overall condition. But you also had depression. The younger you are, the shorter the disease duration, the extent of the BSA, skin type, darker skin types had a greater impact, but not to say lighter skin types are not affected. And then the face or hand lesions, where you could see it, would have an impact. Now, we know that makes sense to us as dermatologists, but what does that do to individuals? Because one of the hardest things about vitiligo is it doesn't hurt, it doesn't itch. So why are we treating it? Well, it's probably because of this. PHQ-9, which is the gold standard for screening for depression, the percentages were on average 55%, but if you're younger, on the face, darker skin types, shorter disease duration, you tend to have higher rates of depression. 55%, that's so much higher than the US population and the global population. And then you look at the types of mental health diseases, anxiety, depression, bipolar disorder, ADHD, OCD, all much higher in this population. So dermatologists, we see people through a lifetime. And those of us who have taken care of vitiligo patients we could not manage or have not been managed, the impact is on the mental health. It's a disease of well-being. We measure pigmentation, but we're really assessing well-being, and that's quantified it. And if you look at these impact scores across the world, different countries have different impacts, and we looked at it throughout the world. And here's the references, but India approached 90% on the depression levels. This was work done by a bunch of my colleagues throughout the world and published. Now, going back to the pathophysiology, I want to come down to the pillars. And Amit talked about how the oxidative stress has an impact. The melanocyte stress is also a theory of keratinocyte adhesion defects that might be a factor in the oxidative stress that reduces the bonds between the keratinocytes and melanocytes that turns on that immunomodulating effect. And then you also have the melanocyte reservoir, which is another factor. Vitiligo is kind of like a tug of war. Once you have non-segmental vitiligo, remember there's two types. Segmental, about 50%, one half of the body, localized, develops and usually doesn't progress. And then 85% of populations with vitiligo have the generalized type that can progress. Well, in that tug of war, you have melanocytes coming back and forth. Once you have vitiligo, you have it for the rest of your life. But the question is, can you see it? And if you're losing melanocytes faster than you're replacing them, it's going to be apparent. But if you're replacing them faster than you're losing them, it's not apparent. And that's what our therapy is designed to do. We want to manage the immune system, reduce the oxidative stress, and then ultimately encourage the melanocytes to come back. But if you don't have a melanocyte reservoir, you tend to have the disease. And we talked about the immunology over here. And then kind of putting this all together, you have inflammation, you have oxidative stress, and then you have an impact on the melanocyte reservoir. If you target inflammation, oxidative stress, and the melanocyte reservoir, you tend to be able to manage the disease. So those are going to be the treatments and the pillars. No more pathophysiology. Baby Elenita, go to sleep. It's okay. So set expectations when you treat people with vitiligo or individuals with vitiligo if they want the treatment. It takes time to treat. It is not going to be 2 weeks and your itching is gone. It's not going to be like these incredible biologics that we have for psoriasis and for atopic dermatitis. You're talking 3 months, 6 months. Most of the studies are going past 52 weeks to obtain their endpoint. So it takes time. If you counsel from the beginning, you reassure the patient. But if you give them a cream and call me in 2 weeks type of attitude, they won't trust you anymore. But if you walk them through the journey, you're able to get them to a better place. You have to assess the well-being of the patient. If you do not assess the impact on their life, and it won't always come in the first visit, you're not going to be able to counsel these individuals effectively because they have to be motivated to do all these treatments, but you also have to be able to give them tools such as support groups, camouflage, based on what's going on with their lives. If you have a young person who has genital vitiligo but refuses to be intimate, that has to come out slowly. If you have a 56-year-old Caucasian male who's established in his career but won't leave the office and won't seek a promotion, it has to be established. If you have a 72-year-old grandma who will never go outside the house and won't babysit her children because she gets a tan and isn't doing the core thing that she wants to do in her life, you have to establish that. So that well-being has to be done. And then you have to know a couple of things. There's a regional component to vitiligo. As Simal Desai, our president, says, the face is fabulous. The face will tend to respond. The area that has one of the greatest psychosocial impacts, luckily, is the most responsive to all of our therapies. Then it goes to the rest of the body, and then the phalanges, the tips of your fingers, the tips of your toes, are the least likely to respond. So if somebody walks in with acral involvement of the tips of the fingers and toes, it's very hard to treat them with the established modalities. So you have oxidative stress. What can you do? Antioxidants. You can use diet, polypodium leucothomas, superoxide dismutase, and we can talk about that in a little more detail. Ginkgo biloba is also used. If you have T-cell based immunology, you have different options. You have tacrolimus, ruxolitinib, topical steroids, pulse steroids, and oral JAK inhibitors. And if you want to target melanocyte biology, which you have to, consider phototherapy, surgery, and alpha MSH. Now, This slide is all you really need to kind of understand about the treatment of what we have for vitiligo, plus the counseling component. If you don't do the counseling, you can't treat effectively. But if you get this part right, you've had the three pillars. And often we use all three approaches to get to repigmentation.
These are truncated replays from our original recorded sessions. Join us next year to get the full impact of the SF Derm experience.
Thank you for listening to the Future of Dermatology podcast. Remember to hit that subscribe button and share the podcast with your friends. The more you share and subscribe, the more we'll be able to grow and share our dermatology knowledge. If you have burning dermatology questions, feel free to leave them in the comment below, and we would love to address them in a future episode. And please note that this podcast is not intended to substitute for medical advice from your doctor.